Good evening, everybody, and welcome back, my friends. Tom Snyder with you here on the Monday. Jeez, the Thursday night radio show. It's starting to get to me, folks. I need a trip again. I really do. We're with you for the 10th of October, 1991, out of ABC in Los Angeles, California. See, I got all that right. Joining us tonight is the one and only king of weird radio, Dr. Demento. The Dr. Demento Show, now commemorating its 20th year on the radio. More than 180 stations spreading the sounds of dementia to over a million people every week. Dr. Demento was born in Minneapolis, Minnesota. He began spinning discs at the tender age of 4 years. His father introduced him to Spike Jones' Cocktails for Two, and that was all she wrote. He began building his record collection while a junior in high school. He has everything from rock and roll to electric blues. He moved on to UCLA. He has a master's degree in folk music studies. And as I say, Dr. Demento now celebrates 20 years on radio on over 180 stations. Demented Discs on the Thursday Night Radio Show out of Southern California.
It's time for the Sears Home Sale, when you can get some of the lowest prices of the year on beautiful Sears home furnishings, like the lowest prices of the year on a wide selection of carpets. Save $12 a yard installed on rich DuPont Stainmaster shimmering woods carpet in 28 decorator colors. And get not one, but two of our best-selling swivel rockers for just $299.99. And get an ottoman absolutely free. But hurry, the sale ends October 26th. So get to Sears' huge home sale and rake in the savings now.
Hi, Jack Frost here. You know, before I get too busy with a hard freeze, I wanted to make sure you get to Sears Brand Central. Because right now, the AT&T Cordless Telephone 4300 is on sale at Sears, lowest price ever. Just $69.99, save $10 through October 12th. It's got two-channel selection from the handset, and you can page the handset from the base. Now just $69.99 at Sears Brand Central, the brand you want at the store you trust. Boy, I'd love one, and I could just call you guys. I mean, once you get to know me, Jack Frost, I'm a pretty cool guy.
Sears Days is winding down to its last few hours, so hurry in and save today on items like our three-level wash Kenmore dishwasher. Save $40, now just $279.88, our lowest price ever. Our SuperGuard 40 steel belted radials are as low as $21.59 for the P155 ADR13. And our Craftsman 50-piece mechanics tool set with case, a $60 value, is only $39.99. But there's no time to waste. Sears Days ends Saturday.
Now, there's a math course on cassettes called Hooked on Math, which makes learning math simple. Simple because Hooked on Math is set to music. This way, kids learn quickly, like words to a song. And when they master addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division, they'll go right to the head of the class. If you want your preschooler to excel, or if there's an older student who needs help with math, call 1-800-ABCDEFG. 1-800-ABCDEFG.
We are back with Dr. Demento, who joins us tonight. By the way, Rhino Records has now released the Dr. Demento 20th Anniversary Collection of the greatest novelty records of all time. As I say, this is on CD and cassette now from Rhino Records. Doc, it's always great to have you here. I go back with you to the days of television in Los Angeles and later NBC, and it's a pleasure to see your smiling face.
So great to see yours, Tom. And hello, everybody.
Now, the novelty records, these are records like the one I mentioned, Spike Jones, Cocktails for Two, the Purple People Eater, Hello Mother, Hello Father, which Alan Sherman made popular, I believe, back in the late 50s or 60s. Mm-hmm. These are really not demented discs, or are they?
Oh, I certainly consider them within this this province of dementia that has grown up around me. Demented, of course, originally meant losing one's mind, being bereft of one's mind. But
right.
To me, it just means something that doesn't take itself quite as seriously as usual. It's a very broad area, certainly. It's very, very subjective whether something is demented or not demented. To me, it just means whether it fits the show or not.
Gotcha.
But I mean, all those records, there was a lot of intelligence behind them, certainly, if that's what you're leading to.
Right. Now, I mentioned that when you were 4 years old, your dad introduced you to Spike Jones and Cocktails for Two, and you developed an immediate interest in this sort of thing. True?
Oh, yeah, sure. That's true. Along with lots of other things, too. The classical music that my dad loved to play, the popular music that I heard on the radio, especially when rock and roll came in the 50s when I was in junior high school. I was just ripe for that. And,
like you, I thought the Spike Jones City Slickers collection was wonderful, and I remember being one day in Schuster's department store back in Milwaukee, And I was going through the records. They were all 78s at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw one by Spike Jones and his orchestra. So I assumed that this would be another Cocktails for Two, or what were some other ones that he did with the City Slickers?
Oh, the William Tell Overture Doodles Weaver.
Yeah. And so I bought this thing, Spike Jones and his orchestra, and I took it home, and it was a classical piece. You know, he had a real
Spike
orchestra.
Jones and his other orchestra, you found one of those. They didn't sell very well, but they were there.
No, but for a time he did try to cross over from dementia into serious music, because apparently he was a fairly good musician.
Oh, he was an excellent musician. Before he started the City Slickers, he was the most demanded studio drummer in Hollywood. He is on literally hundreds of records behind Bing Crosby, Judy Garland, all the greats of the time.
Right.
He's even on, you can't really hear him, but the union sheets, the union rosters of the musicians show that he is on White Christmas by Bing Crosby. I guess all he did was or something like that, but he's there somewhere.
And how did he stumble into dementia? The City Slickers. Have you researched at all?
Yeah, he just got tired eventually of doing what other people told him to do, and decide to form a band with some like-minded drinking buddies of his to kind of thumb his nose at the music, serious music.
All right, so anyway, we got a bunch of cuts here tonight. Do you want to pick them, or should I just go through the list here?
Well, we should certainly hear a little bit of Cocktails for Two, since we've been talking about that.
Okay, so let me have the maestro set that up on the turntable in there, and when was this done?
This was done in 1944, released in 45.
Was this the first of the City Slickers?
No, they made a few before that. They had a hit earlier than that called Der Führer's Face, which is also on my new compilation. And that was their first hit. They started recording in 1941, and Der Führer's Face was 1942, and Cocktails for Two was maybe about their 11th or 12th release, but certainly took the nation by storm and was bigger by several factors than anything else they'd done up to then.
Okay, here's Spike Jones and his City Slickers and Cocktails
for Two. Now, this is going to sound like Waring's Pennsylvanians for the first half minute or so, and then all breaks loose on this one.
Okay, here it is. I don't think that's the one we're looking for.
Don't touch that dial.
That wasn't quite what we had in mind. Now, I threw my engineer Mike a curve here because he's got some other ones loaded up, but we'll give him a couple of seconds to find it, okay?
Oh, okay, sure.
What were the records that you played on the first Dr. Demento radio show 20 years ago?
Well, it was quite a mixture. I no longer have my playlist. I guess I didn't think it was a great moment at that time. I know I played some rock and roll rhythm and blues things. Remember Then by the Earls comes to mind.
Okay.
Which goes, beep, 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 beep. It's one of those. And Dear One by Larry Finnegan. But the one that stuck in people's minds was called Pico and Sepulveda by Felix Figueroa. It was one of the few things on that first show which was not rock and roll. But that was the one that stuck in people's minds, at least here in Los Angeles. That is a song, nearly the entire lyrics of that song consist of the names of streets in Los Angeles. And that is not on my new collection, but it has been on some of my
past
ones.
Well, there'd be no sense having it on the collection because the rest of the country wouldn't know what it was all about anyway.
Not quite.
Unless you included, of course, the AAA roadmap of Los Angeles County.
Right. Yeah. Though we do use an instrumental version of it as my theme song to this day.
Here are Spike Jones and the City Slickers and Cocktails for Two, I think.
Mm.
Yep.
Charming scene like this in some secluded rendezvous that overlooks the avenue with someone sharing a delight. Chat, there's some bad and cocktails for two as we enjoy a cigarette to some exquisite chansonette. Two hands are sure to slyly meet beneath a serviette with cocktails for two. My head may go reeling, but my most any afternoon at 5. We'll be so glad we're both alive. Then maybe fortune will complete her plan that all began with cocktails for two.
So there is Spike Jonze. Who's the guy singing now?
Carol Grayson was his name. He was their lead singer for the first 5 years or so.
It's pretty good voice on the guy. I mean,
yes, indeed. He was a legit singer. All the City Slickers were legit musicians. All Spike's bands, all through the years, were fine musicians. They had to be, because everything was... It may sound like chaos, but Spike worked hard to create the impression of perfect chaos.
I'm sure the arrangements...
And every gunshot was meticulously timed, and when they did their act live, they had a company of about 50, and it took a whole train to carry all their props around. They really ran a traveling circus, and every pratfall was exactly, perfectly timed for maximum effect.
So then there was choreography and orchestration that led to all this madness on records.
Exactly.
Okay, now... You know, like, Spike Jonze is one kind of novelty record. Now you get into other records that I remember as a kid, like the Purple People Eater.
Oh, yes.
Flying Saucer.
Mm-hmm.
Alvin and the Chipmunks.
The 1950s.
What I'm getting is, were there stars of novelty records as there were Frank Sinatras and there were Little Richards and there were Fats Domino's? Were there stars of these kinds of records?
Yeah, sure. Spike is one.
Yeah.
And Stan Freberg was one in the 1950s. He lampooned everybody from Elvis Presley to Jack Webb's Dragnet.
No question. He was here one night and played the night that the Avalon Ballroom went out to see. It's one of the funniest pieces ever put on tape.
Yeah, thanks to Lawrence Welk for that.
Yep. Thank you, boys.
He's a genius, still is. Made great commercials for years after that.
You bet.
Tom Lehrer. You wouldn't call his stuff novelty records, but it certainly fits well within the realm of dementia. He's the second most requested artist of all time on my show.
Now, the man's name rings a bell. What's he done?
Tom Lehrer was a satirist, still is. He's retired from show business, but I still consider him the greatest musical satirist since Gilbert and Sullivan.
Mm-hmm.
And he's famous for songs like Poisoning Pigeons in the Park and the Masochism Tango and the Vatican Rag, which certainly outraged the Catholic Church very much in its day.
How does that one go? That isn't down on your knees, up on your toes.
That's the one.
Race around the rosary, see how it goes. That's what we call
doing genuflect, the... Genuflect, genuflect, genuflect. Make a cross on your abdomen when in Rome. Do like a Roman. Ave Maria, gee, it's good to see you doing the Vatican rag. Tom sings it much better.
See, I thought it was, don't be a pope. Here comes the... Don't be a dope. Here comes the pope. He's got the news for all the Jews. That's what we call...
that's a parody of the varsity drag.
Okay,
but
anyway.
Which might have inspired Tom, too. He's a great musical comedy.
And then, of course, there was the ever-popular bridge, 12 Apostles, That's a Lot. Christianity hits the spot. Even Jesus loves the cha-cha-cha. Don't you? It's only a joke now, folks. That's all it is. We're doing jokes here.
Yeah. Well, Tom Lehrer, a great satirist, and made these wonderful songs in the 1950s.
It's like the one of my great hits, Did You Ever See a Jiu-Jitsu? See, it's a joke. It's only a joke. Yes. Yeah. Anyway,
well, Tom was just making fun, too, but his stuff never got played on the radio in the 50s, but it kind of spread from college campus to college campus. I remember I was introduced to it. There was this girl that I had kind of had a crush on in high school, and I went over to
her doctor,
house.
The doctor falls in love.
Yes. I went over to her house with some of my favorite rock and roll records, intending to impress her with Little Richard. She said, no, I want to listen to this. And she put on this little 10-inch LP, and it was songs by Tom Lehrer, his first record. That was my introduction to him. And now, years later, my second most requested artist, and just had the great pleasure of doing an interview with him, which will run on my show next month.
We are with Dr. Demento. His Dr. Demento 20th Anniversary Collection, The Greatest Novelty Records of All Time, is out on discs. We'll get to more demented discs and eventually some of you on the toll-free exchange right after a station break.
Marie Caruso of West Newton, Massachusetts, is telling us about her skin problems.
I teach, and I teach at a community college. I just developed a jewelry allergy because I was just breaking out exactly where a necklace would be, or a watch would be, or a bracelet, something that's on my skin. It was just a very annoying itch, and it would just itch like anything, and you would scratch till you scrape your skin off your arm.
But Marie Caruso got relief using Triple Action Gold Bond Medicated Powder.
Gold Bond has made itself a part of my life. You don't expect a powder to do what Gold Bond can do. I mean, it's relief. It's great.
Gold Bond's Triple Action is like three great powders in one. It has the absorbing action of powder, the medicating action of a proven itch fighter, and the drying action of zinc oxide. That's Triple Action Gold Bond.
The itch! It's gone! Gold Bond is terrific.
Try Triple Action Gold Bond Medicated Powder. Use only as directed. Available at drugstores and supermarkets everywhere.
Stop and Shop is proud of their 20-year history of service to the town of Stratford and the Dock Shopping Center. It was way back in November of 1971. Joe Coppola, the store manager, opened the first Stratford Stop and Shop. Joe was also there in 1988 when the new Super Stop and Shop opened, and he's been there ever since. Joe and his staff help to serve the community by offering the food products they need, but also through community service programs like Apples for Students, where Joe's store donated over 50 computers to Stratford schools, or through Food for Friends, where Joe and his staff are currently working to raise funds for the local Red Cross and Stratford and Milford clergy. Stop and Shop thanks the residents of Stratford for their continued business over the past 20 years, and they invite you to join in the Dock Shopping Center's anniversary celebration this Friday and Saturday at Stop and Shop. There'll be fun for the whole family, from clown shows to car shows, so join Stop and Shop in saying Happy 20th Anniversary, Dock Shopping Center.
Hi, this is WICC 60's JLB, John Labarca, and I'm inviting you to join me for the WICC 60 Morning Show. Every weekday morning, Monday through Friday, 5 a.m. to 10 a.m. I'll be here to get you started on the right foot. Join me and my breakfast buddy, award-winning veteran newsman Tim Quinn.
What is this breakfast buddy? I mean, you know, we're just talking and you got food. Always with the food. What's with the food?
Well, you eat food for breakfast. I figured, you know, it's a nice companion. Along with constantly up data traffic reports from Flight 60 and the one and only Morgan Kaolian, accurate weather forecast from the WICC Weather Center and Chief Meteorologist Joe Fury. We've got great music, our quick question lets you win great prizes every day, and Susan Granger has the entertainment beat covered. And gee, we've got so much, I don't know what else to say, Tim.
I don't know, but I'm sure it'll have something to do with food, knowing you.
That's right. So have breakfast with me and my buddy Tim Quinn and all the other characters right here on Service 60 WICC.
Okay, we're back with Dr. Demento, who will be on...
Jeez,
I thought we were doing something. It's the demented one.
Of course.
Well, wait a second.
Staging a meet here.
Cornfield meat.
I hope right. Not.
Give me a little history here on the Purple People Eater, and then we'll place it.
Okay, the Purple People Eater was the fastest-selling 45 in history, really, in 1958, and it was by Chev Woolley, who is a man who's done a lot of things in his life.
Yep.
His career started as a country western singer with a song in 1946 called Peeping Through the Keyhole, Watching Jolie Blonde, and he kind of went outward and upward from there, made dozens and dozens of records, meanwhile started a movie career, and he was in the movie High Noon with Gary Cooper. He was one of the bad guys, was also in films with John Wayne and James Dean, and then he was in the TV series Rawhide for a number of years while continuing his musical career all at the same time.
Very accomplished guy.
Yeah, he invented an alter ego called Ben Colder and did a lot of comedy records under that name. But his musical apex was certainly the Purple People Eater, which just took the nation totally by storm in 1958. In only its second week on the market, it was the number one record in the country.
All right, let's find out why. Here is the Purple People Eater.
Coming out of the sky, it had a one long horn and one big eye, like a Mr. Shaking in the city. It looked like a purple people eater to me. It was a one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
One-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
A one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater. Sure looks strange to me.
One-eyed.
Well, he came down to earth and he lit in the tree. I said, Mr. Purple People Eater, don't eat me. I heard him say in a voice so gruff,
I wouldn't eat you, cause you're so tough.
It was the one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
One-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
One-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater. Sure looks strange to me.
One horn.
I said, Mr. Purple People Eater, what's your line? He said, eating purple people, and it sure is fine. But that's not the reason that I came to land. Well, bless my soul, rock and roll, flying purple people eater. Pigeon toad, undercoat, flying purple people eater.
We were short, short.
Friendly little people eater. What a sight to see.
Oh.
And then he swung from the tree and he lit on the ground. And he started to rock, but really rocking around. It was a crazy ditty with a swing and tune.
Sing a bop, bop, a boop, a lap, a loom, bam, boom.
Well, bless my soul, rock
and moo. Flying purple people eater. Pigeon toad undergrowth. Flying purple people eater. Sight to see.
Purple
people went on his way, and then what do you know? I saw him last night on a TV show. He was blowing it out, really knocking him dead. Playing rock and roll music through the horn in his head.
You know, it brings memories rushing back for me. I don't know about the kids in the control room, but geez, that was a big record.
Oh, yes. I remember I was out with some girls on a double date.
You got around, didn't you,
Doc? Yeah, a little bit. And the other guys and me were all singing the Purple People Eater over and over again until one of the girls said, "Stop that! We're tired of that!" And we said, "Well, what do you want us to sing?" And one of the girls said, "Sing something slow." And I immediately burst into, and the others all immediately joined in. It was a one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple. That was the only slow song we wanted to hear that day.
In your collection of records, do you have straight stuff, too? Do you have jazz, classics?
Yeah, because it's not always easy to say where dementia ends and the other stuff begins. Dementia tends to be funny stuff, but I certainly treasure my jazz and blues records and try to keep up with the modern rock scene, too.
On a typical Dr. Demento radio program, how many records would be played?
Oh, let's see. I guess about 30.
In a one-hour show?
No, 2 hours.
Oh, two-hour show.
Right.
So then there's not a lot of patter. It's mostly you give...
Yeah, right. I'm the straight man to the records. I introduce them.
Like the PDs used to say, fellas, play the records and run the commercials. Don't get cute. We don't have time.
Sometimes I do get a little bit cute, I guess. I tell the stories behind some of the records, especially introducing some of the things that have interesting trivia behind them, because people love trivia.
How about Sarah Cynthia Sylvia Stout would not take the garbage out?
That's by Shel Silverstein, a great man who's done so many different things.
Is there a little vignette we could tell about that after the station break? Because I got to go away here.
Okay, yeah.
Good.
Lots to say about him.
We are with Dr. Demento. I'm going to open the toll-free exchange to all dementia fans here at 800-248-0852. That is 800-248-0852. Back with the doctor and many of you on the toll-free exchange and more great music on the Thursday night show after these messages. You're on the radio show, and I'm Tom Snyder on Service 60 WICC.
Hey, I'm a nice person. I deserve it. Sears semi-annual fine jewelry sale, here I come. Gold, gemstones, pearls, watches, even diamonds are on sale now. 25 to 65% below comparable values elsewhere. And if I spend at least $100 on my Sears charge, I get 0% financing. I pay nothing till next year. Sears semi-annual fine jewelry sale is over on the 20th, so I better hurry. If you're a nice person and love a great sale, maybe you better hurry too.
It may never become a leading issue at medical conventions, but it's still an exciting discovery. Sufferers of minor arthritis have found they don't always need a pill to relieve their pain. They've discovered eucalyptamine ointment. Eucalyptamine's unique formula penetrates for deep relief. It increases blood flow with oxygen and nutrients and helps relieve pain around sore joints, so you may depend less on pills. Eucalyptamine ointment helps eliminate the pain and quite possibly the pain relief pill. Use only as directed.
Listen, I'm very picky when it comes to tires. I only want the best.
Now, Sears introduces Bridgestone Road Handlers. Sears is so confident of these new Bridgestone Road Handlers, they'll let you drive them anywhere for 1,000 miles. And if you don't agree they're the best tires you've ever owned, Sears will replace them free. Plus, Bridgestone Road Handlers carry up to 60,000 miles of tread wear-out warranty. See store for complete details.
Come on, who's gonna back you better than Sears?
Hi, Jack Frost here. You know, before I get too busy with a hard freeze, I wanted to make sure you get to Sears Brand Central. Because right now, the AT&T Answering System Telephone 1504 is on sale at Sears' lowest price ever. To $79.99, save $20 through October 12th. It's got a built-in phone, and you can get your messages from any touch-tone phone. To $79.99 at Sears Brand Central, the brand you want at the store you trust. Boy, I'd love one, and I could just call you guys. I mean, once you get to know me, Jack Frost, I'm a pretty cool guy.
Do you know
there are only 44 sounds in the English language. 44. And when you learn these 44 sounds called phonics, you can read and spell almost everything. That's why Hooked on Phonics is so successful. We've set these 44 sounds to music, making learning to read simple and fun. So get hooked on phonics and take the mystery out of learning to read. Call 1-800-ABCDEFG.
Service 60 WICC, your number one radio station, and we check the winning numbers, the Connecticut Daily 395, the Play 4 3871, and the Service 60 WICC forecast for tonight becoming mainly cloudy, low temperature near 55 for the overnight. For tomorrow, some morning sunshine, otherwise cloudy with a few showers developing, high at 65. And for Friday night, cloudy, lows down to 50. The outlook for Saturday, mainly cloudy with a few more showers likely, highs around 60. Currently it is 60 degrees at your weather station, Service 60 WICC.
Okay, we are back with the Demented One, Dr. Demento. He's on the air every weekend on 180 radio stations around the country, playing demented discs for the enjoyment of his many fans. I have a lot of calls, so before we get to Sarah Cynthia Sylvia Stout would not take the garbage out. Let me get some of these people in the mill here, okay?
Okay.
Terrific. Charlene in Chanute, Kansas. Hi, Charlene, you're
on. Oh, I can just barely hear you.
Well, Charlene, then turn up your hearing aid.
Okay. I was going to ask about Please, Mr. Custer, I Don't Want to Go.
Oh, yeah, by Larry Verne, a huge record in 1960. That was the year that three novelty records made number one, all in very short succession. So it was another vintage year for that stuff.
What were the other two?
Itsy Bitsy Teeny Weeny Yellow Polka Dot Bikini by Brian Hyland and Alley Oop by the Hollywood Argyles.
Itsy Bitsy
right.
Teeny Weeny.
But Mr. Custer, that was a great one. One of the first novelty songs to kind of, well, it didn't exactly take the Native Americans' point of view, but it did not point them as the villains, like many other novelty songs did.
Yeah, I just thought it was so funny.
Okay, thanks, Charlene.
Yes.
Thank
all right,
you.
Bye-bye, hon.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, Tom. Thanks for calling. You got it, Charlene. Now, Please, Mr. Custer was one of the three novelty songs that made number one in that year, 1960.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I look all through the 20th anniversary collection. I don't see it on here anywhere.
Well, it's on a lot of other collections.
Well, why isn't it on the big one?
Because we looked through all the 20 years of requests and looked for the things that got requested again and again and again on the Dr. Demento show. Now, some of those, it's about evenly divided between things that were big hits on the charts in
their
day and things that were hits since the Dr. Demento show started.
And, like, how many different novelty records would you say there are in the history of the recording business?
Oh, many thousands.
That many, really?
Yes, right.
Oh, so then we couldn't have one big, you know, Dr. Demento's final and complete collection would be, the CD that ate Hollywood, right?
Right. Yeah. Yes, it would.
Wouldn't happen. Okay.
There's plenty of room for more volumes, though.
Right. Volumes or volumes?
Volumes.
Oh, okay. Mark in Oxon Hill, Maryland. Hello.
How you doing, Tom?
Pretty good, Mark.
Listen, first of all, I want to wish you a happy 4th anniversary on the air.
Oh, thank you very kindly.
It's been late. I tried to get through the other night, but I had a little trouble.
Well, the lines were jammed with congratulatory calls and wires.
Okay.
You know, bottles of champagne arriving at a nonstop rate, Mark. It was incredible.
I can believe it.
Yeah, we're sending the champagne out to veterans' hospitals and orphanages.
Dr. Demento.
Yeah.
I listen to your show over WHFS here in Washington, D.C. And I was wondering if you have ever heard of an album called Christmas on the Ponderosa with a Bonanza cast.
Yeah, oh yes, yes, indeed.
Could you tell me what record store in Los Angeles I could get that from?
Well, it's been out of print for many years. There are stores like Music and Memories, which is on Lancashire Boulevard in North Hollywood, has a lot of things like that.
Okay, I'll check that. Now, another thing I want to know, do you have a record in your collection that was on 20th Century Fox Records called Miranda by Adam West?
Yeah, I think so. I have to go back and look.
Mark, I sound like the hair-lipped dog. Mark?
Yeah?
You really threw me a curve here when you said you wanted to know the name of a record store in L.A. where you could find Christmas on the Ponderosa.
I can't find it anywhere else.
Well, but I mean, what are you going to fly from Oxon Hill, Maryland to L.A. to buy the record?
No, I'll mail it. I'll send it for I'll send a check.
Oh, I got
In most cities, there are stores that cater to people looking for hard-to-find records.
All the record stores in this area don't have it, though.
Well, look in the yellow pages. Maybe there's one that you've missed. And buy a Goldmine magazine, and you will find hundreds of ads in every issue from rare record dealers who all do mail order.
All right. When I was talking about Miranda by Adam West, I was wondering if you could possibly play it on the next show you tape for syndication.
No, I'll try and...
I can't call your 900...
of RIAA, but this
Well,
guy,
the computer on my shoulder sometimes takes a moment to dial something
to
up.
Synapse it in, right.
Right.
Okay. Michael, in Santa Rosa, California, you're on the air with Dr. Demento. Hello.
Hi, what a privilege to talk to the two of you.
Thank
Mr.
you.
Mr. Snyder, just want to say I enjoy your show.
Thanks.
It's a pleasure to be talking to you. And for Dr. Demento, I had a question on that. There was an album called Mr. Jaws.
Uh-huh.
Do you remember that?
Oh, yeah, Dickie Goodman.
The single was
the number one record.
Who was that?
Michael, the doctor remembers every record that's ever been made. You don't have to ask this man if he remembers a record. He remembers every record that's ever been made, okay?
Okay.
The man has a computer on his shoulders, okay? Just understand that now.
Okay.
All right.
Let's see if we can get his name.
Well, Dickie Goodman did that one. He's the same man who did the flying saucer that we, I believe, mentioned earlier.
Also not in the collection.
There's some sort of contractual thing. We couldn't use any Dickie Goodman this time around. We did use his things in the past, so look for him in oldies record bins. He did dozens and dozens of records, all following the same format. They pretend to be news interviews, but instead of regular answers to the interviewer, he's answered with little bits of hit records. This was a formula that the late Dickie Goodman followed for many years to great success.
Till he became the late Dickie Goodman.
Yes, unfortunately.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
All right, Michael, thanks, pal.
All right.
All right, bye-bye. Mike in Minneapolis, hello.
My hometown. Hi, Mike.
Hello there.
Hi.
Pleasure to speak with you tonight, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Question I had for Dr. Demento was concerning a record I'm hoping you might have. I heard it about 8 years ago. Probably one of the most demented dance tunes I've ever heard, called the Thorazine Shuffle.
Oh, yeah.
You've heard of it.
Wait a second. I think we've got the doctor here.
the synapses haven't dialed up the artist's name yet. But.
I don't even remember where I heard it, but it just sticks out of my memory. Cause
I guess then there's no chance you could hum a few bars.
No. It was a pretty sick tune, but I just can't remember any of the words. But I did enjoy it.
Okay. Well, we'll look for that one. I'll look through my files at home and try and dig it up.
I do enjoy your show quite often on
KJ104
here, and although we got to get up to crack it on Sundays and listen to it.
Well, some things are worth that, Mike.
Yes, it is, and I'd like to thank you, Tom, for putting on a good show here. I listen to you quite often also.
Okay, and did you want to mention the call letters we're on, too, or do you...
This is KSTP AM. Right.
Okay, now, do you know Stan Hubbard at all?
I've heard of the man. I've seen him in the news before.
Well, yeah, he owns K. He's very, very big in Minneapolis. But did you know that when his kid was in high school, the kid had a Mercedes Benz? But now, Mike, it was a diesel.
Good man.
All right, Mike. Thanks for calling.
Good night.
Bye bye. Dave in Nordheim, Wisconsin. Dave, thanks for your wire, my friend. And how are you?
I'm doing fine, Tom.
I really appreciate the wish, my friend. Thank you.
You're very welcome. But last time we spoke, you accused me of having a twisted mind. You're sitting across the table from the guy who did a lot of the twisting.
Okay.
I grew up listening to this man's the program, as a matter of fact, I'm sitting here. And in my lap, I have your 1985 boxed set.
Oh, yes. Yeah, a six-record set I did back in the days of vinyl.
Yeah. I assume people remember that.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering about... there's a friend of mine who lives in Culver City who sent me out a bunch of tapes from, like, 1978, 79, 80, when you were on the old KMET.
Mm-hmm.
And you had different sections, the different little corners of the program, I'm assuming partially because it was a longer program than the syndicated, right?
Yeah, that's true.
And there was one in particular I was curious about. I think it was Musical Mike's Jazz Corner?
Oh, yes. We'd play a jazz record on every show.
I was wondering, A, how many other segments along those lines have you had over the years, and B,
that was really about it.
Resurrecting.
Well, maybe. If we get a few more calls like yours, we might bring the Jazz Corner back. We had a Poetry Corner for a while.
Mm-hmm.
Not too many other things, though. I kind of like to keep it free form.
I do remember the Audio Torture Chamber.
Yes.
What was that?
The Audio Torture Chamber was where I would play the worst records I could find.
Tom, you have not lived until you've heard Ernie Banks sing disco.
Right. That was one of the worst.
You know, I think I'd choose death.
We ran that for about a year, and then I just couldn't bear to play records that just weren't quite as bad as the ones I'd played the year before.
Got you.
We may bring it back.
Did you ever get around to the French language version of Disco Duck?
No, that may be a new one on me. Send me a tape.
Oh, I'm going to have to dig it up. All right. Okay.
All right, David. Thanks for joining us, and thanks for your anniversary wish, my friend.
Yeah, you're very welcome.
All right, sir. Bye-bye. Bye. Talk to you soon. We're back with Dr. Demento, and we will get to Sarah, Cynthia, Sylvia Stout, Would Not Take the Garbage Out, and more from the demented mind of the doctor after a station break.
If you've always wanted a powerful vocabulary, but found most programs boring, try We the People, the cassette program that combines college-level vocabulary with American history. So now, while developing a dynamite vocabulary, you'll become an expert on American history. Get We the People, the vocabulary program that teaches more than just vocabulary. Call 1-800-ABCDEFG.
It's time for the Sears Home Sale, when you can get some of the lowest prices of the year on beautiful Sears Home furnishings, like the lowest prices of the year on a wide selection of carpets. Save $12 a yard installed on rich DuPont Stainmaster Shimmering Woods Carpet in 28 decorator colors. And get not one, but two of our best-selling swivel rockers for just $299.99. And get an ottoman absolutely free. But hurry, the sale ends October 26th. So get to Sears' huge home sale and rake in the savings now.
Tell me, sir, how do you think Buick improved the all-new LeSabre for 1992?
Well, that's a tough act to follow, but they probably made it better.
Better?
Yeah, I mean, why would they have changed Buick's best-selling car at all if it weren't to make it better?
Exactly. Uh-huh. New LeSabre styling isn't just more beautiful, it's more aerodynamic.
Which means it's better.
There's more horsepower from its improved 3800 V6.
Better.
And a larger trunk with a low lift-over design to make loading and unloading easier.
That's better on your back, isn't it?
LeSabre's new interior is even roomier.
I knew that.
And with a standard driver's side airbag and available anti-lock brakes, it's safer, too.
Better yet, huh?
And you know, even with all these changes, you still get that same great Buick quality that goes hand-in-hand with the name LeSabre.
So, basically, what you're trying to tell me is that this new LeSabre is...
better.
Aha!
So test drive the all-new 1992 LeSabre at your local Buick dealer.
I'll do that.
The new symbol for quality in America.
And what could be better than that?
Now, honestly, somewhere between the evening news and your favorite reruns, you've got some spare time, right? Well, if you'll spend some of that time with a National Dynamics language program, we'll have you speaking and understanding Spanish, French, Italian, German, or Japanese in 30 days. No books, no classes. Just our audio tapes in your home, car, or portable cassette player. Call this number today, 1-800-545-1985. That's 1-800-545-1985. Now, really, how many reruns can you watch?
People are counting on you.
Grandma, you're making chocolate chip cookies.
Well, I promised, didn't I?
But what about your arthritis?
I found something that's good for my arthritis.
And that's Arthricare, the only rub that's warming yet odor-free. Arthricare relieves minor arthritis pain for hours. Use only as directed.
I love you, Grandma.
I'd love you too, sweetheart.
And I love your chocolate chip cookies.
Warming yet odor-free Arthricare, because people are counting on you.
You're listening to Service 60 WICC.
Okay, before I go back to the calls, and I'll tell you, we're lined up with millions here tonight. Tell me just a little bit here about Would Not Take the Garbage Out.
Shel Silverstein, a real Renaissance man, first became known to the public with his ribald cartoons for Playboy magazine.
Oh, surely.
Yeah,
surely.
He started writing songs and singing at the same time and found a lot of success in country music. He wrote A Boy Named Sue for Johnny Cash and many other songs that were country hits didn't cross over. Wrote The Unicorn that the Irish Rovers made a big hit out of. But he's best known to the world for his children's books, A Light in the Attic and Where the Sidewalks End. So both of which have sold in the millions, and he set to music one of the songs from Where the Sidewalk Ends, and I decided that that was a thoroughly demented song, so that's become a great favorite on the Dr.
You
Demento
know what's
show.
Interesting to me is that guys like Sheb Woolley and Shel Silverstein, who do these demented discs or novelty records, are in reality very accomplished people.
Yes.
I mean, these are people of great accomplishment.
Oh, yes.
Wow, Shel Silverstein. Anyway, here is just a smidge of Sarah, Cynthia, Sylvia, Stout, Would Not Take the Garbage Out.
Oh, Sarah Cynthia Sylvia Stout would not take the garbage out. She'd wash the dishes and scrub the pans, cook the yams and spice the hams, and though her parents would scream and shout, she simply would not take the garbage out.
There's just a little bit of it.
Yes, and he goes on to tell in great detail what was in that huge pile of garbage.
Right. Well, not here he doesn't.
Okay.
All right. Here's Nissen in Muncie, New York. Hello.
Hello.
Hi, Nissen. How are you?
Hi, guys. Dr. Demento.
Yeah.
I've had those two songs, the Eggplant That Ate Chicago, which most people I tell it to or sing it to, don't believe ever existed.
Mm-hmm. Sure did. It's
and
a big hit,
Newsweek,
too.
Which is a rather morbid
right.
version of a demented song.
Right.
I don't even remember who did them. It's been so long since I heard them.
It's Good News Week was by a British group called Hedgehoppers Anonymous, a studio group formed just to record this silly song.
Right.
The Eggplant That Ate Chicago was by Dr. West Medicine Show and Junk Band, which in reality was Norman Greenbaum, who later went on to make an even bigger, not quite as demented hit called Spirit in the Sky. That kind of religious tune with the blues boogie guitar accompaniment.
Gotcha. Okay, I recall it vaguely. Anyway, Nissen, give us a few bars of The Eggplant That Ate Chicago.
From me?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because nobody else knows it. I don't know it.
You better watch out for the eggplant that ate Chicago, cause it might eat your city soon. And
yeah.
It goes on from there.
Gotcha. Thank you.
If there are any stories or backgrounders on those, I would love to hear them.
Well, I told you about as much as will fit, I think, in our space.
Right.
Thank you so much.
Okay, my pleasure. Thank you.
All right, good night, Nissen.
Stay demon.
Thanks for calling. All
take
right.
Care.
All right, Mike in Dallas. Hello.
Hello, doctor.
Hi, Mike.
Mike Zuhar with the Dallas Dementia Society.
Oh, yes. Hi, Mike. Good to hear from you.
Listen, I got a couple questions, and I think we're probably the first people on the air tonight that still do not have the show in Dallas.
Alas.
Unlike a lot of other people that have called in that are actually listening to the show, I've got four questions, and very quickly, one, any news on when a station might be coming here and what's
well,
going on?
Well, thanks to your fine organization, we have some leads, but nothing I can talk about on the air. But,
okay.
Nothing definite, I'm afraid.
The second question I had, that Tom Blackwell had talked to me the other day and said that the tour for your 20th anniversary show was ending in Los Angeles this week,
yes.
And I was kind of curious why there wasn't a stop in Dallas.
Well, probably because there's no station there to publicize it.
Right.
Well, that's what I thought, because everybody in the club keeps asking me.
Yes.
And did you ever get the 20th anniversary card that we sent you?
Yes, I did, and thank you so much. Oh, I have a chance to publicly thank you for that spectacular fine card.
Great.
Really the biggest and the best card that I got.
Well, Wade wanted me to tell you that he made the rotating disc that looked like a record.
Okay.
All right.
And what is John Mann Moser doing?
He's working in Los Angeles for the Westwood One Radio Network.
Great. Well, again,
and he does things for my show.
Just wanted to take a
thanks a lot.
Say hello.
Okay,
Mike is a good friend.
Okay, thank you, Mike. Glad to hear from you.
Thank you.
All right, bye-bye now. Mike, of course, enjoying our show on KLIF in Dallas, 570 on the radio dial. I wanted to ask you something about, on the call board here, it said the old gag, do they get your show in Dallas? You know the gag, right? Well, they hear it, but they don't get it, right? Don in Seattle, Washington. Hello.
Hello, I have a question for Dr. D.
Okay.
You got it.
One of the reasons I listened to your show for years and years back in the 70s was to hear a song called The Ballad of Irving by Frank Gallup.
Well, it's on my new collection, so you can hear it again.
That's what I called. Is that available on the new collection?
Yes, it is. We even found an extra verse, which was cut out of the original release back in 1966, and have restored it.
Now, another question for you. You always have your funny five. Now, do you have your own personal five favorites?
It changes all the time. I mean, if I were to choose records to take to a desert island, I'd take my new Rhino collection and probably some Bartok and some Beethoven and some Bix Beiderbecke and some Robert Johnson and a bunch of other stuff. So my favorite songs, a lot of them are great music.
How about contemporary music, things that we would hear on the radio today?
He loves MC Hammer.
I've admired some of his things. I like the Meat Puppets better, though.
He likes
that's
the meat?
That's the tape I played on the way down here tonight.
And he's nuts for Two Live Crew. Crazy, crazy for it.
Okay, thank you, folks.
All right, Don. See, bye. Don, to tell you, if I say it, hey, from my mouth to Don's ear, you know, I mean, geez.
Will there be demented discs in the future that you would gather and cull from rap records? I mean, some of this stuff.
There's a lot of comedy rap out.
Yeah.
A lot of the best things can't really be played on the radio in this free country. But there's some other things that I've been playing, some nice parodies. Rap is certainly eminently adaptable to comic purposes.
We're with Dr. Demento tonight, mm-hmm. talking about the Demented One's 20th anniversary collection, The Greatest Novelty Records of All Time. It's out now from Rhino Records. We also have the Dr. Demento video, which is in the stores, the Dr. Demento tour, the Dr. Demento t-shirt, and of course, the coffee mugs and home soldering kit.
And watch for my special coming up on the Comedy Central cable channel.
Watch for that too, and the home soldering kit. We'll be right back with the Demented One after these messages.
I hate my daughter's dance class. Well, not the class, you know, the waiting around. So I get the car washed instead, or I bring it to Mr. Goodwrench Quick Lube Plus. My GM dealership guarantees a complete lube and oil change in 29 minutes or less, or the next one's free. Of course, it's never actually taken that long, but hey, as long as they're done before dance class.
Your GM dealer's serious about putting service back in the service department, and the faster free guarantee proves it. For details, see your participating GM dealership. For the nearest location, phone 1-800-GM-USE-US.
Break out your sunglasses because I've got something that'll brighten your day and help your writing sparkle. This is Jim Summers for ValuRite Pharmacies. And right now, participating ValuRites have assorted packs of Bic wavelength pens and pencils for just $1.79. They come in real bright, colorful designs. Brilliant, I'd say. Just look in the yellow pages for ValuRite Pharmacies, where you'll always find great American values and quality that comes shining through.
The clock is ticking away on Sears Days, so hurry in and save today. On items like women's V-neck and crew-style hand-knit sweaters, regularly $25 to $28, now just $19.99. Our generous 27 by 50-inch all-cotton towels are just $2.99 each while quantities last. And all men's sweaters are 25 to 40% off, including our popular jacquard, now only $14.99. You save $10. So don't waste a Sears minute. Sears Days end Saturday.
Do you know there are only 44 sounds in the English language? 44. And when you learn these 44 sounds called phonics, you can read and spell almost everything. That's why Hooked on Phonics is so successful. We've set these 44 sounds to music, making learning to read simple and fun. So get Hooked on Phonics and take the mystery out of learning to read. Call 1-800-ABCDEFG.
I'm Alex Trebek with another fun fact from the American Spectrum Encyclopedia. Today's answer is, his exhibitions in the American Museum in New York included the original Siamese twins and General Tom Thumb. I'll return with a question after this.
Mommy, I need to do a book report on Alaska.
Look in the American Spectrum Encyclopedia, dear.
Mother, why was the Berlin Wall put up?
It's in the American Spectrum Encyclopedia.
Honey, let's start planning our cross-country vacation.
Look in the American Spectrum Encyclopedia.
The American Spectrum Encyclopedia. A colorful one-volume reference with over 17,000 entries and 3,800 illustrations. An encyclopedia for the entire family. And the only one endorsed by the American Booksellers Association. In bookstores everywhere.
In 1871, this showman opened his famous traveling circus and 10 years later merged with James A. Bailey's show to become the greatest show on earth. Today's question, who is P.T. Barnum? That's today's fun fact. I'm Alex Trebek.
Okay, we're back, and here is Reed in Jackson, Mississippi. Hello.
Hey, Reed.
Guess what, Reed? You're out of here. Aaron in West New York, New Jersey. Hello.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening.
One show tonight.
Thanks.
I have two questions.
Go ahead.
I wanted to know where the name Dr. Demento came from.
Well, I was playing Transfusion by Nervous Norvis on one of the first shows I did on a commercial station, and the boss's secretary wandered into the studio and said, "You got to be demented to play that on the radio," including a couple words which I can't say on this program.
You didn't just give her one, you know.
No. I said something like, "Well, this was a big hit when it came out," one of the other disc jockeys at this station overheard this remark, and the next time I came in, without telling me in advance, he just introduced me on the air as Dr. Demento, and it stuck. So thank you, the obscene Stephen Clean, wherever you are. Okay, everybody at that station had funny names, so I needed one too. Yes.
Thank you. My other question is, I lost you several years ago, and I wanted to know if you're getting demented in New York these days.
We're looking. We're still trying. I was in New York recently, did a show at the Bottom Line, and we got some interest, but it's the nature of syndicated radio that we keep stations drop out and change formats, and we keep having to find new ones.
Some you win, some you lose.
Yes.
Yeah.
It wouldn't hurt to call or write your local station.
Okay.
All right. Thanks, Aaron.
Good night.
All right. Bye-bye. Last question tonight from Yosef in Baltimore. Hello.
Good evening, both of you.
Good evening.
It's a delight for me to hear Dr. Demento's voice. I used to live in Los Angeles, and since I've been in Baltimore, I don't know how to find him. But
well, I am on, can I mention the station?
Go right ahead.
WHFS.
Are you on WHFS?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. I have two questions for you.
Okay.
One, there's a group that was used to appear on Steve Allen's show every once in a while. They put out a few albums, Bonzo Dog Doodah Band.
Oh, yes, a British
Whatever
group.
Whatever happened to them?
A British group. They were together for five fruitful years, made a tour of America opening for The Who, finally broke up. Vivian Stanshall is still active as a TV personality in England. Neil Innes went on to do some work with Monty Python and various other projects. The others, I don't know. Roger Ruskin Spear made some solo albums, but they all got lives.
All right, the time is gone, my friend. Doc, it's always a pleasure to have you on here. Congratulations
always
on your tour.
Always great to be with you, Tom. Okay, we go back to the tomorrow show, and it's always a lot of fun.
Way back beyond that, the new collection, the Dr. Demento 20th Anniversary Collection, the greatest novelty records of all time, is now available on Rhino Records, cassettes, and CDs. I'm T.S. This is the Thursday Night Radio Show out of Southern California.
They're coming to take me away!
Thanks for listening, everybody.